Welcome to Creative Development with IFC. I'm Makhtar Diop, the Managing Director of the International Finance Corporation. My guest today is Mr. Wally Badarou, a distinguished composer, musician, thinker, futurist, and producer with roots in France and Benin. He is known for his exceptional talents on keyboards and synthesizers, and his prolific work as a session musician, but also as a music film composer. He has recorded with English groups like Level 42, Mick Jagger, Grace Jones, Manu Dibango, Gregory Isaac, Fela Ransom Kuti, Miriam Makeba, Yusundur, and the list is very, very long. Today, Wally continues to create music and champions the rights of music authors and composers as a board member and advisor for industry organization. Welcome, Wally, to Creative Development with IFC. So, Wally, you are a precursor in fusion. You know, at that time, there were very little people. You had, the old players, Mandibango, Hugh Masekela was playing with jazz, but very little few people in fusion. And all of a sudden, you are playing and composing with the top bands in the UK, Level 42. You're coming also for something which is a family of Beninese doctors. And there is a very strong tradition, for those who don't know, of medicine in Benin. Other friends that I know from Benin as either uncle, a father, or a cousin who is a medical doctor. Tell us a little bit that journey, you know, when your parents wanted to go and study in Europe, maybe space and aviation, and you end up playing music and making it a profession.
My parents had an incredible journey in life because they came from Africa. They came from Benin. At the time, it was called Dahomey. My father was among the latest in the family and in his brotherhood, and he was the only one going to school. The rest of the family didn't go to school. I mean, their parents only thought of him going to school because it was sort of a brand new thing. And he managed to succeed in at school to the point where he was sent to France to carry on his studies. And so he met my mother. They both met in Benin, but then they really sort of got together in Dakar, Senegal, because that's where you would have to go to go to high school before you would join college. And they both studied in medicine in France. And that's how I was born in Paris, France. That makes me a French from day one. And that's a very important thing because it means that my very formative years has been in France. I've heard about Edith Piaf and all those French singers before I discovered the musicians from my continent of origin. And that makes a huge difference. Because I was accustomed to not only French pop, but also classical music and all that. Film music as well. I mean, my parents were very enthused by film music. So when we traveled back to Africa, because my parents, once they finished studying, they went back to Dahomey to practice. We remained in Dahomey and I was aged between 7 and 17. So I spent about 9 to 10 years in Africa. Then I could absorb the African part of things for having lived in Africa, for having lived in my country of origin. But I always felt like I did not really belong, even though I was originated from Dahomey. I could barely speak any Dahomeyan language because my native language was French. That's one of aspect of my whole life, which is that I've never belonged to nowhere. And I always felt foreigner or alien to anything I was in. In Africa, I was a French. In French, I'm an African. That's the way it is. And this carried with me even in the music area. We went back to France. I started to become enthused with anything with aviation, space. You know, those were the years of Apollo 11 landing on the moon and all that. I mean, the whole of the spatial race, I was really, really into it. I could name each and every individual astronaut on the Mercury, Gemini, Apollo, you know, I knew them all. And I was into aviation. I was into the DC-8. I was into all those engines and all. I didn't want to become a pilot, but just the idea of engineering, aviation engineering, was really fantastic, which sort of got me into feeling comfortable with the technology. Technology never was a problem for me. It was always something that I was really embracing as a tool to actually go beyond whatever or wherever you were. So I went back to France. I was age 17, but then I was not very good at mathematics. That made me forget about the aviation courses, obviously, because you needed to be good at mathematics. So I was sort of going to do some literary stuff or law. And I ended up studying in law in France, Nanterre. But gradually, that thing that I had within, which is called music, sort of took over. And that was it. The rest of it was basically listening to records. Thank God we have records. Thank God there's that thing called sound recording as a technology that will allow these things to be a mentor. You know, I was raised listening to Ray Charles, James Brown, Stevie Wonder, Santana. All those people were incredible teachers by just listening to what they did. And probably I had a good ear and a good memory, so I was kind of trying to decipher things. My first instrument was a flute. Then I had a melodica. Then I had some kind of ukulele. Then I had all kind of instruments that my parents, because my father was into music as well, I mean, but it was just a hobby for him, you know. So he would bring back sometimes one of those instruments and I'll be playing those things. When we were back to France, my little brother brought back an electric bass at home, and my parents were like, "Oh my God, you're talking about serious thing. What is this thing? What is this thing doing in our home?" Because all they could see, you know, it was like heavy metal, you know, the smoke, the spliff and all that thing. They knew it was something that you shouldn't get into. So they sent me to discourage my brother to carry on doing those things, you know. And so I went to one of their rehearsals. You know, we're talking about high school bands, you know. And they were doing some Deep Purple kind of thing, you know, Led Zeppelin, you know. And then I was like, okay, I want to be your organ player. We didn't even have an organ. Those were the days of the organs, you know. And that was it.
But Wally, I have to interrupt you. There is something that is very interesting and common. I have seen so many musicians of our generation having something like you. Parents were abroad, diplomats of some time. They're supposed to take a path of studies which were more formal. And I have a couple of good friends that I can mention to you, a schoolmate. Someone like Jean-Pierre Senghor, who ended up playing 20 years with Gilbert Togil. Baboy Lee, guitar player, also we ended up in Paris playing with other. So, and it was the same pattern, you know, educated pattern. Parents we said we have exposure to you to Europe, where maybe students, they were born there, they went to send back, and they end up doing music.
70s were incredible years in terms of how many incredible stuff were coming out of Africa. We're talking about Fela Kuti, we're talking about, you know, Osibisa, we're talking about all those incredible bands. We're talking also about what was happening in America. I mean, those were the incredible years for Stevie Wonder, for instance. I mean, his records of the 70s are like one of a kind. I mean, he never could duplicate that afterwards. We're talking about Herbie Hancock, we're talking about Headhunters, we're talking about Weather Report. I mean, all those incredible sounds and incredible endeavors. People were not just trying to imitate. People were not trying to compete. People were trying to push the envelope in terms of what it is that we can do that is going to blow everybody's mind. When you listen to Shaft, you know, Isaac Hayes, it was like, oh my God, this, we're talking about symphonic African-American music, you know, and it was, wow, and jazz. And so fusion came naturally to me. I mean, it was bound to be because back in those days, music was going to be more electrified by Miles Davis. The synthesizer was still a machine of experience. It could only play one note at a time. didn't have memory. So you had to forge the sound at the same time as you were actually creating the pattern that you wanted to play, and you had to perform all of that at the same time. We were striving for excellence and singularity. We were not trying to be like the others. You wanted to be able to be singled out.
But Wally, you're so right. Yes. I think that the 70s need to be revisited and documented in terms of creativities. I fully agree with every single word you said. This personally was also the music that we carried. I carried in my teenagers and later. And everything that had been done in the continent, in Europe, in US, the vibrancy that you had there, the creativity was a kind of a unique period. But for one reason, it hasn't been, to my view, recognized enough. And maybe something needs to be said about it. But you have something quite also interesting. A lot of the people were, you know, either friends when they were coming from a French-speaking country, or in the UK when they were coming from Ghana and from the English-speaking. You cross the channel. You are one of the first who jumped and started working with Level 42, Foreigner, Mick Jagger, Gregory Isaac, etc. So it was kind of unique, and you caught this Oxbridge accent that I've never been able to get in spite of my years spent in the UK. So you spend a lot of time in the UK and absorb also this part of the culture, which was quite also different and unique in terms of fusion from what was happening in France. How did it happen?
I went to the army, French army. I did my military service as a French man. And out of my military service, I decided I was going to go back to school because I didn't think that music was going to be my thing. Even though things was happening to me, I was just too afraid to be, you know, of that very precarious lifestyle. So I went back to school, I mean, to the university. And then I had a call from Manny Dibango because he heard of me, you know, doing some stuff. And just come and play on my record. Okay, I come over, you know, and I do my little thing. And then I do another one, and then another one. And then 4 months, you know, that was it. I was into music for good. And I signed as an artist at Barclay Records in France. And one of the executives at Barclay Records, one day he calls me and said, Wally, all we want is you come over, you play piano, you improvise whatever you want, and we give you 1,000 francs. How about that? How can I refuse that? I went for it. And that did me good because at that session, I met 2 musicians. That's the kind of thing that he didn't tell me that I was going. I thought I was going to just be by myself. But we ended up being a trio. There was a bass player and a drummer, both from England. And this is where the first time I was working with English musicians. At the end of the session, they came to me and said, Wally, we love what you do. Please come over. We're working on something of our own, you know, which is totally different, of course. And boy, I did that one session in Paris. After that one, the first one, right? And that session was pop music, a single that became huge in England and in America. That's how I crossed a channel, because I had to go and promote that single in England. And then by doing so, I met another drummer. I would say, Wally, I want you to meet that bass player. We didn't have a name yet. It became Level 42. But I was still signed to Barclay Records in France, which is the reason why I never joined officially Level 42. And at the same time, that very single, pop music, was huge in America. And at that time, Chris Blackwell, founder of Island Records, was looking for a keyboard player to do the next Grace Jones album, along with Sly Dunbar and Robbie Shakespeare. And some common friend of us say, oh, you want to hire this guy? He's Wally Badarou. He played on that tune, you know, pop music. Oh, yeah, is that so? I need him. And that's how I met Chris Blackwell. Whether or not I was at the right time, at the right place, or the other way around, which is that I was doing the thing that people wanted me to be a part of because they needed the kind of sound or contribution that I could bring to them, is something that for a debate. I had a double life, one in England, working with Level 42, and one in Nassau, Bahamas, where Chris Blackwell had his studio, Compass Point, because of the sound that we managed to do with Sly Dunbar, Robbie Shakespeare, and all that. He named the band, the recording band, the Compass Point All-Stars. And then We got Joe Cocker, we got James Brown, we got Robert Palmer, we got the Talking Heads, Mick Jagger and all that coming over because they loved the sound that we were doing over there.
This is so fantastic. People who were following Fusion, they never understood why you are not a formal member of Level 42. Now you understand it. But let's turn to something which was quite interesting. As you said, your engineering mind, your technological mind pushed you to really push your envelope on everything, which was a synthesizer, electronic, Moog, everything. You touched to all of them and you were able to move the envelope. But also, it brings us to something which is very contemporary, which is copyright and digital rights of musicians. Because this is a world where you express your own creativity through electronic instrument. And it is a world where you have blockchain, you have a lot of things happening, artificial intelligence. I think that's very important to think about it very carefully. And I know that you have been spending a lot of time thinking about it and doing that. I must say that in my own life, in previous life, I had to when I was in government, to help changing the copyright law in my country for musicians. But that was a time where the digital was not as advanced as now. Where are you on this project, on this work that you are doing on copyrights?
It's a constant evolving situation. And things that were true just 5 years ago are different nowadays. My position as a musician, and I would say as a composer from improvisation, allows me to be speaking very loudly and to articulate the very problems that we in contemporary actual music we are facing. Basically, especially in Africa, musicians start with one riff, one idea, one set of chords, and then gradually there's something called a groove or something called a succession of chords, which a melody will stem out of, which words will be put upon. It would rarely be just the other way around, which is like something that you would find in Europe, for instance, or in the Western world. You would have people thinking of something that they want, a message that they want to put together, and then they will create a melody to stick to that, and then they will bring some musicians and arranger to do things. In Africa, and especially in the world of jazz and fusion and rock, basically, it basically usually comes from the music. Music is first and foremost. The story behind Sex Machine, James Brown, I had Bootsy Collins telling me it all was just about a riff, you know, on the bass, you know, with his brother playing the guitar, and that was it. And then James came on top and did Caleb and all that thing. So the reason why I'm talking about this is because of that, I had a very, very precise idea of how to talk and be defending the creator from standing from the improvisation point where you don't know the future of what you're going to be doing. Before the digital world, you would put your idea onto tape. And because of the hiss and everything, you would have to go to a regular studio to properly record it. And in between, you would have a producer, a publisher, all those kinds of things that would help you protect your work if things were done properly. Nowadays, you don't need that anymore. Anybody with a laptop, even with an iPhone, the incredible music software available to anybody. If you have an idea and if you have talent and skills and knowledge, you can put up any music with any tool today. You will do it digitally and you could instantly have it put onto YouTube or whatever platform around. And if you are not careful enough, your stuff will just go unprotected. And that's the bulk of what's happening in Africa. For instance, in mechanical rights in America, they've put up a collecting society called the MLC, which is a mechanical license collective, which has about $2 billion of undistributed royalties. Most of them, the bulk of which coming out of from abroad of America, which is basically Latin music, music, African music, European music, all those things that have not been properly documented in America are generating huge amount of money that is sitting there. So basically, our challenge in Africa, I would say, is documentation. The digital world allows documentation so that whatever you do would have your signature into it, which would be indelible, and so that wherever it goes and however happened, whatever happens to it, that being transformed, being mashed up or whatever, we can still trace who you are, so that eventually, if there's money being made, you could get the money that is owed to you. That's one of the things that I'm really working on.
The idea is to have a kind of ledger, like in a blockchain, whereby in a DAW like Sonar or Cakewalk or Cubase, whatever you're using, you play your things, and you will have a marker in the ledger who said Wally Badarou created this melody. Yes. These four bars, melodies, day, X day, in this condition, and will go somewhere in a database. So whoever, in a ledger, whoever wants to use it later on, we have your signature.
Absolutely. And as you just described it, you know that it already exists in this and that format. The problem with the existing systems is that they are not...
interoperability.
Exactly. Yeah. The challenge on that is also that it will help us solve the bulk of what AI, whatever may happen to AI, would produce. In other words, we should be able to find out where that music that AI is feeding from, because AI needs huge data to be doing what it does. We should be able to trace, and it is feasible. You will hear people saying it's not feasible, it's too complicated, it's much too much. Sorry, guys, it is feasible. It's just a matter of convening on one set of protocol that should allow copyright to be embedded into the file itself. And that's feasible.
No, that's a great, great project. Now, I want to hear a little bit what you say about your more recent solo production. There is always space coming. Your passion about space and your early age seems to be following you through your career. Am I right or wrong?
You're so right. And it's so funny that you should say that, because actually you're talking about you're talking about just not just in the nature of the music that I do, but also in the spacing in between the releases. I put a lot of space. Basically, I've been privileged enough to be working on songs in the past that generated enough revenue as a composer that I can take my time and do only the things that I want to do. It's a privilege. It's a real privilege. And I'm not saying that what I'm doing today is better than what I did before, but I like it better simply because I have better control on it, and I can have the time to think, sit and look at it and let it rest. And if years later it's still standing to me, and say, I could say, yes, that's something that I'd like to put out. Where before I wouldn't be able to do that because time is money and all that, and you had to provide and all that, which is good because I managed to do stuff that people today believe are great stuff. But honestly, when I look at what I did, and I don't want to downplay anything. It's just that I know where there are things that I could have done better. Not that it would have been more successful, but I would have had the intellectual satisfaction of having reached the thing that I was looking for, if only I had spent just a bit more time. Now, talking about my own thing, compared to my collaboration, collaborating with people means that you have an audience with you. Music is always live as soon as there's one person in the room. It only takes one person in the room other than yourself to be live, because that one person is like your first public, the first audience. And that's our problem in the studio. That's the problem with collaborating, which is that you're not the sole judge of what you're doing. And in other words, it is much faster. And quite good things can come out of it because it was first take, it was fresh, and you didn't have to over intellectualize it. But there's another side of yourself who thinks that, well, yeah, maybe, yeah, I understand, but I shouldn't have left that one note that annoys me, you know, and it's going to stick for years from now on because it's recorded, it's printed, it's for good, you know what I mean? So my solo effort take much longer than any other stuff. Not that they are better, I just want to rely on myself and being my first and last judge on what comes out of my studio. Once it's out of my studio, it's different. I mean, it belongs to people, you know. There's nothing much you can do about it. But for as long as it is in my studio, I want to make sure that it really fits exactly what I wanted.
Well, it's really a pleasure. I could spend hours with you talking about the things. But I want to say that it's such an enlightening conversation. A brilliant mind that you are, a lot of humility, and being a citizen of the world. And I think that is something that today must resonate a lot in this world, which is a bit troubled, as we are living in. And I really thank you for being the precursor of bringing what you have brought to the music of the world, not the music of Africa, not the music of Europe, not the music of UK, but to the world, and also thinking about the challenge of today and tomorrow. And it's been a huge honor to have you today in this conversation. And thank you so very much for your fantastic contribution to the music of the world, not the world music, the music of the
thank world. Thank you so much for saying that. Music of the world. Yes, thank you. Makhtar, it was my pleasure too. I mean, I know where you're coming from, and I know that I was clearly understood. Thank you.